two cats and the prince's boy. The date is Boxing Day. The setting, a house in New Jersey that required a subway ride, New Jersey Transit, and a transfer to Track 5 in Newark. Steamed vegetables and curried butternut squash soup were some of the usual staples that day, though I never made it past the crackers and salted cashews that were on the table. A 15-second film clip playing on the closest lampshade had my full attention. The film in question was in my eye, and I watched as it separated and resealed itself into a purplish swirl in the center of my vision. With dead weights for shoes, I slowly make my way down the dimlit hallway to the bathroom, where a flick of the light switch showed that my face had disappeared in the mirror, as did the faucet and soap dispenser. A purplish ink stain was in its place. A quiet whisper to Catherine, my dear friend and family by choice, that I had to leave, who promptly drove me to the nearest hospital, where the ophthalmologist on call waited 5 hours to phone in that he didn't think it was an emergency. Nice. Instead of having to have me transfer back to Track 5 in Newark, Catherine drove me all the way home to the Bronx, and the next morning, struggling to read numbers, I dialed deep within myself for help. The date, December 27th. The setting, a doctor's office in Midtown. The smell of sanitizer and eye solution hangs in the air. I got here by instinct alone, slowly walking down the sidewalk as I watch in amazement and fear as cars enter my peripheral vision, vanish in the center, and come out whole again on the other side. On what seems like an endless pile of medical forms, I look on in horror as my penmanship morphs into that of a 5-year-old as I struggle to fill in boxes and see the signature line. For the next 3 hours, I see nothing but bright flashes of light and hear nothing but commands. Look up, look down, look left, look right. Don't blink. Tilt your head back. A needle appears in the corner of my eye. Instead of fear, I am temporarily entranced by the artwork the needle writes inside of my eye before it vanishes in the drops of a local anesthetic. It will take time for the medicine to work. It will take time, all the doctors tell me, but no one can tell me how long that will be. No one can tell me why this happened. I just blame the predisposition I've had since birth. That simplifies things for me, because the next few days are not that simple. I'm greeted every morning to that purple blob. I dodge an endless stream of questions from disembodied voices over a telephone line. I am a soaked up sponge that is on the verge of being wrung out. New Year's Day, and I am standing in the middle of the store of 18 miles of books on the verge of collapse. I realize the artwork from that needle can only heal me so much. Ink and paper are my true medicine. The thing I loved the most and feared to do, read, was the therapy I needed the most. I peel myself off of the bookcase that I'm leaning on for support and grab the nearest book I could find, The Prince's Boy by Paul Bailey. I save the exhaustive crying fit to when I am safe behind the walls of the apartment on 2nd Avenue that will be my temporary home for the next 7 days, and where the only beings to hear my cries are cats in physical forms only, Jupiter and Goldie. Watching them as I always did when their humans went away, only this time they were the ones looking out for me. As I unleash my pain and fear in that house full of words, they camp themselves on either side of me, radiating their own healing energy. They stay with me as Dinu, my therapist, leaps from the printed pages between my hands, clear in his dress, but not quite so in his face, as he takes my hand and guides me through the sights and sounds of his world. I sit with him in cafes and train stations. I watch as he gets drunk off too much wine and curls up at night as he struggles to understand his identity and emotions. Each night, he comes back to show me more of his world, and the details become a little clearer, a little more defined. As if knowing that I am measuring my progress through watching everyday objects, Jupiter and Goldie actively participate as I try to watch TV, read the back of a label, or simply look at their faces. One evening, forgetting the blank black hole in my vision, I look down at Jupiter and with alarm think that his left eye has permanently closed. He quietly positions himself so that both portals of his eyes are within my sphere of vision. By the end of that week, the faucet starts to slowly come back into view, as does the soap dispenser. And though it will take a long time, in mirrors and glass panes, my reflection will begin to solidify as well. Still the same, but forever altered.